Harper One and Harper Audio present Wannabe, Reckonings with the Pop Culture That Shapes Me by Aisha Harris. That's me. Introduction. Thank you, Rebecca Bunch. So there's a scene in the final season of the brilliant musical comedy series Crazy Ex-Girlfriend where Rebecca Bunch is lamenting her long list of well-documented destructive behaviors. Her friend and roommate, Heather, attempts to console her by saying that the worst thing about Rebecca is the fact that she flushes her tampons down the toilet. "I'm sorry about the tampons," Rebecca reluctantly concedes. "Again, I didn't know you weren't supposed to flush them. I will wrap them in toilet paper and leave them in the trash to smell like you want." "Well, you could also just take out the trash," Heather replies, calmly but slightly irked. Now, I love this exchange and think about it a lot for a few reasons. The deliveries by Rachel Bloom as Rebecca and Bella Lavelle as Heather are chef's kiss, the product of an established familiar rapport which feels utterly true to who these characters are and how their relationship has evolved over the course of several seasons. And it encapsulates part of what made Crazy Ex-Girlfriend such a subversive delight: its weirdness and frankness in discussions of women's bodies and points of view. This is a show, after all, in which a recurring gag involves characters singing bits of a song called Period Sex. But the main reason I'm obsessed with this moment is because it concretely altered my life, my womanhood. In it, I stumbled upon a stunning revelation: that you are not, in fact, supposed to flush tampons down the toilet. Yes, I was Rebecca Bunch. An early 30-something with years of tampon-wearing experience, I had been painfully unaware that my bathroom trips while on my period rendered me a menace to society, if only for a few minutes every few months. Who knows how many plumbing systems I'd clogged or how many bodies of water I'd polluted with my ignorance. I shudder from a place of deep and immense shame at the thought of having left behind a never-ending trail of slowly degrading sanitary products and an untold number of sewage pipes. Thank the medical gods for inventing the kind of birth control that can effectively eliminate periods. These days, I basically never have to worry about this anymore. I've learned a lot of lessons about myself and how the world works in this way: inadvertent self-formation by way of popular culture. I've devoured countless hours of movies, shows, books, music, and theater over the course of my life, first solely as a consumer and then later as a professional critic and podcaster. I guess it was bound to work out that I'd fix my garbage disposal habits thanks to an encounter with a fictional TV character. Pop culture is also how I've worked through more existential issues, like a complicated relationship with my own name and my commitment to never having kids. When I'm searching for meaning, validation, or a challenge, I'll often find it through an exchange between fictional characters or in the lyric of a transformative album. The truth is, most of our lives bear the imprints of the pop culture we consume, whether the consumption is casual or, as in my case, obsessive. A song that lives rent-free in my head: Muffin Top from 30 Rock. The stuff that entertains us or just merely distracts us often finds a way of seeping into our quote-unquote real lives. It can be as frivolous and fleeting as the Rachel haircut from Friends, as enduring as doing the cha-cha slide at weddings, or as singular and all-encompassing as Beatlemania. Sometimes it's inspiring, like seeing Sidney Poitier win the Oscar or reading books about a group of smart and enterprising tween and teen girl babysitters. In other cases, it's insidious, like the way decades' worth of baked-in propaganda on shows like Cops and Law & Order have primed Americans to feel overly sympathetic toward law enforcement. It's nearly impossible to escape this world untouched by pop culture. Movie-going, TV-watching, music-listening, it doesn't all just happen to us. It helps shape us and informs how we move about the world, whether we're conscious of it or not. But how we interact with it has shifted in some significant ways, creating infinitely new possibilities for both connection and division. And of course, our social mores shift too. I'm a middle millennial who was born at the end of the 1980s, but came of age in the 1990s and early aughts. My generation, the killers of cable TV, the auto industry, and casual dining, among other capitalistic entities of yore, often gets a bad rap for being overly concerned with relating to and seeing ourselves within pop culture. We're labeled vapid, the so-called selfie generation, and unhealthily obsessed with things like representation and cultural appropriation, because we tend to be the loudest critics when, say, Tilda Swinton is cast in a role that was originally conceived as an Asian character, as in Doctor Strange, or J.K. Rowling spouts yet more trans-exclusionary rhetoric. Bill Maher can barely make it a week without sneering about woke millennials and our cancel culture. And naturally, this ire has begun to trickle down to Gen Z, who have spent virtually all their sentient lives online and are rejecting labels and traditional identities at increasingly higher rates than millennials. But we're just embracing the reality of pop culture's indisputable impact on our society, only now with the added benefit of more diversity, more immediacy, and a bigger platform, social media, than generations prior. We're looking inward and looking back on many of the ideas and values we were taught by our parents, our teachers, our peers, and yes, our culture, and recognizing that a lot of what we've been taught to accept or ignore was wrong. Movies do not change, but their viewers do, Roger Ebert wrote in 1997. He was referring to Fellini's La Dolce Vita and how each time he experienced the film, he identified with the central character differently and in a way that was dependent upon whatever stage of life he was in at that moment. He's right, of course. We can all relate to the experience of a song or a movie hitting you differently at different points in your life. Now that I'm around the same age as three of the Sex and the City women were during its original run, I watch the show very differently than I did when I was 16, and that's a good thing. No more wildly unrealistic expectations of what dating and socializing is like as a young adult in a big city. As we individuals grow and change, so does the collective audience. And that collective audience always includes the next era of creators who might have the opportunities to do things differently, as we've seen lately with the likes of Issa Rae, Bo Burnham, Jerrod Carmichael, The Daniels, and Greta Gerwig, all of whom are pushing boundaries and breaking new ground. Pop culture shapes us, and we shape it right back in an invigorating feedback loop of creativity and interpretation. It's worth embracing this. Like most people, there are times when I just want to turn my brain off for a few hours, lose myself in entertainment, and never think about any of it again. But most often when I experience something, I want to dig into it. I want to understand how it all fits into the bigger picture, i.e. culture and history and life and all of that. When I react a certain way to something I watch or listen to, I want to figure out why. When I sense a trend emerging, I want to put it in context. I love wrestling with and unpacking the irrepressible cultural forces that have moved me or made me cringe, made me proud or insecure, or just left me utterly confused. For me, there's a thrill in engaging on a deep level until I've made some sense of it all. The essays in this book are an invitation into that wonderful, maddening process and the tensions that come with it, all through the prism of one Black, suburban, 1990s kid turned 30-something city-dwelling journalist who, on the very rare occasion when she does need a tampon these days, no longer flushes said tampon down the toilet. Chapter 1. Isn't She Lovely? Chance the Rapper paused on the other end of the phone line. It was merely a couple of seconds, but in the moment it felt long enough to me to be a little awkward, especially because I couldn't read his facial expressions. Had I unintentionally poked a beehive with my questions? I wondered in the space of that loaded pause. It was summer 2019, and I'd successfully pitched my editor at the New York Times the idea of a lighthearted Q&A with the artist about his well-documented love of The Lion King. He's rapped about the movie on many different occasions, pegged to Disney's upcoming CGI remake. I figured it'd be fun to shoot the shit with the jovial rapper who has frequently sprinkled Lion King shoutouts like, "Call me Mr. Mufasa, I had to master stampedes," into his lyrics. He was as chill and chatty in conversation as I'd expected him to be. He proclaimed the Lion King's superiority over Hercules because the latter just takes you to a bunch of different places until you just get to the end and it's like, was it worth it? This is the correct take. But about 10 minutes in, he let slip that he'd served as a consultant for the remake's director, Jon Favreau. This was news to me. At the time, there were only rumors he might have contributed to the movie's soundtrack. Nothing beyond that. When I asked him to elaborate on this consultant work, I could sense that he could sense that I'd unwittingly stumbled upon a new scoop. His guard went up a little, and he hesitated ever so slightly. I don't know how much you know about my involvement with the movie, so could you just tell me that before I start talking? He asked politely. I mentioned the scuttlebutt regarding his possible musical input and that I was aware of a previous interview he'd given a couple of years prior about auditioning for the voice role of Simba. When does this piece come out? He followed up tentatively. Probably a day or two before the movie, I responded. trying to conceal my nervousness that he might immediately shut down the interview. And then there was that pause. Eek. Sorry, I never got... He trailed off. What's your name? I was confused. That was not where I thought this interaction was headed. Oh, Aisha? Another pause. Then, oh, Aisha? Yes. Yeah. Can I ask you, are you Black? His tone was sheepish, echoing the deeply self-conscious mode we'd both apparently fallen into for the moment. I was slightly flustered, temporarily knocked off my guard. Yes, I'm Black, I responded, my face scrunched up in bewilderment. For a second, I was grateful he couldn't see me. Okay, I didn't know that. Earlier you were saying stuff about being Black and I didn't know, and now I know. Another pause. So, can I just say that I fill a small role in the movie without that being a separate story that comes out ahead of this piece? This was not the first time someone had heard just my voice and didn't realize I was Black or was at least unsure about it. I've been told I quote-unquote sound white many times in my life. Now, to be clear, I don't mean this in the exceptional Negro way. You know, how certain self-hating Black people try to signal how different they are from other Black people and complain about being teased for acting white because they speak proper. Rather, my accent and the timbre of my voice, if you can't tell, a product, I guess, of Midwestern roots by way of Mississippi on my dad's side and New England roots by way of Baltimore on my mother's, don't often automatically connote Black American for some people I encounter. Think more Kerry Washington than, say, Niecy Nash. For instance, a couple of months after I joined NPR's Pop Culture Happy Hour as a host, a listener tweeted that they thought I sounded just like my co-host, Linda Holmes, who is lovely and someone I admire greatly, but who is, unlike me, white. The observation stung a bit, because the last thing I wanted was to carbon copy her style. But I reassured myself, hey, I'm still trying to rediscover my podcast voice, its range, my cadences, my groove. Maybe I'm unintentionally mimicking her style as I do so. It's okay. I can work on that. But then, a week or two later, while I was on the phone with my mom, she complimented me on my hosting duties while also noting that she'd started listening to a recent episode thinking I was the host, only to realize halfway through that it was actually Linda she was hearing. I hadn't even appeared in that episode at all. My own mother. Love you anyway, Mom. Even in my writing, I've been mistaken for white by virtue of the publications featuring my work having predominantly white staff. Early into my first journalism job as a culture writer at Slate, back when I was still masochistic enough to read that cesspool under articles known as the comments section, I recall coming across a reader huffily dismissing a piece I wrote as the ignorant rantings of a white person. I can't for the life of me remember what I wrote, only how shocked I was at the time that someone would think I was white. Another reader chimed in to say, actually, I'm pretty sure the writer's Black. I assume this person just didn't bother reading the byline like a lot of readers. If my voice doesn't give it away first, my name is the first clue for strangers that I might be Black. In Chance's case, it seems to me he was trying to suss out whether or not he could trust me with this accidental revelation about his involvement with the new Lion King. If he confirmed that I'm Black, maybe he'd feel a little more at ease? Depending upon the person, their assumptions, and the context, Aisha makes me Black. Or it makes me a Black Muslim. I'm not Muslim, though I can't count how many chatty cab drivers have tried to use my name as an entry point to a conversation by inquiring as much. I get that they're just trying to be friendly, but please, dude, it's 5 a.m., the sun isn't even up yet, and the last thing I want to do before boarding my flight today is have you mansplain to me that Aisha was one of the Prophet Muhammad's favorite wives, is a thought I've had so many times. Or it makes me a person with a hard-to-pronounce name. It's pretty straightforward. Aisha. Or it's an excuse to sing a corny song by a one-hit wonder boy group. More on that later. But at my youngest, I understood only these things about my name. My parents picked it out because my dad especially wanted his children to have African names. It means life in Swahili. And the name Aisha is mentioned on Stevie Wonder's Isn't She Lovely, a tune that was often spun on vinyl or sung by my parents in our household. I was born to Frank and Teresa in New Haven, Connecticut at the end of the 1980s, Smack dab in the middle of what I've been told was a brutal winter, back when snow was still a thing that happened with great frequency in the Northeast in January. I share a birthday with Mary J. Blige and Alexander Hamilton, whose name, like mine, has been the subject of a popular corny song.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.